I thought I'd make a video about what I'm trying to do with Adaptable Ape and where it's going and what it's about. So Adaptable Ape started about 20 years ago when I started to think, how does the brain work, and came to the conclusion that it's based on balances. And then over the last 20 years, I've basically extended the ideas. And I realized that it's not just a balance that tells you more or less, but it's a balance that comes to equilibrium. So it's like algebra. And it's more than algebra because it's what is called an unequal arm balance, which means that rather than just this or this, it tells you exactly how much more or how much less. But what it actually is that the fulcrum of the balance is movable. So when you put two different weights on it, it is out of balance, and then the fulcrum moves and it comes into equilibrium. So the fulcrum could be here or here. So the mathematics of that is x minus y over x plus y, and that gives you a result of either minus 1, 1, or 0 if it's in the middle. And it shows you the relative relationship between two weights or two values that you're comparing. So you can compare pretty much anything you like. So one of the interesting things is muscle tension. So you compare the muscle tension of two muscles in relation to each other. And that becomes like a coordinate in the brain and tells you and tells the brain through muscle tensions how to put your arm or your hand into a specific position. And the other one would be emotional value, and that would be you would have the emotional value of two behaviors and you weigh them up, and that decides which behavior you will follow. And then when you follow the behavior, you have your imagined emotional value and your actual emotional value, and you compare the two together. Now, the weighted balance means that you end up with either finding that it moves this, the fulcrum moves this way or this way, and it either is the case that you are the imagined emotional profit was more than the actual emotional profit, so you are dissatisfied, or less and you are satisfied, and the unequal imbalance will tell you exactly how much more and how much less satisfied you were. And the interesting thing about that is that you can then define learning and play behaviors, because the result of that balance becomes the basis of an emotional reward, and then you try to optimize that satisfaction and dissatisfaction. And then what happens is that you actually come into a point where there's no more increase in satisfaction, because your actual satisfaction or your actual emotional value that you were expecting, the actual emotional value and the value you're expecting become the same, and therefore there's no more satisfaction, and then there's no more playing. So the other useful application of that is now clearly that comparing imagined emotional profit with actual emotional profit and weighing it up in a balance and getting these different levels of satisfaction can explain a huge range of behavior. But one of the interesting things you can explain is you can compare the emotional profit of the behavior of following against the emotional profit of the behavior of leading. Now, if you find when you meet someone that the emotional profit of leading is bigger, then you will try to lead. But actually what people try to do is they try to push the other person down, so that put them down so that they follow and they get to lead. Now the important thing here that it isn't the case, you're not just looking at leading in terms of leading in an autocratic way where you lead and rule everything. It's more about in an individual situation. So I lead in knowing about cars, or I lead in knowing about football, or I lead in knowing about beer, or, and these are all man things, and obviously women might have different or the same. So you lead in that, you try to lead in an area of expertise, and that was the evolutionary idea of it. And then the other thing is that you get this sense of the important idea about that is that you want to push people to follow, and the way to do that is to make them feel anxious, because when they feel anxious, they feel uncertain. And when you lead, you feel certain and you feel high status, because you release serotonin, and that is a status hormone, and it makes you feel high status. So when you push the person to follow, they become insecure, anxious. So the purpose of anxiety is actually to control people. You're made to feel anxious because people want to control you. And it makes you uncertain. But the lovely thing is, from a human perspective, is if you do follow, then you get certainty out of the leadership of the person you're following, and then you worship them. And when you worship, you actually get a serotonin high too. You get the reward too. So it becomes like a pact where the leader feels dominant and high status and is certain about the world, and the follower is certain because they follow the leader, and because they worship them, they get the serotonin highs. Hallelujah, hallelujah. So that's the lead follow. Now the other thing is fairness, the fairness balance. So in the fairness balance, it's more complex, it's more difficult to do, because it's the imagined emotional profit of my behavior of cooperating, of my benefit from the cooperation, versus the imagined emotional profit that you get. So it's what I imagine you to have. So it requires theory of mind. Now, if we try to keep that in balance, and when it comes out of balance, we experience different emotions. So we either feel gratitude, which when we feel we've had too much, or we feel guilt when we've had too much. If we're not feeling gratitude, we feel guilt. And the purpose of the fairness balance is to decide whether you should love or hate. So this is where the evolution, my human evolutionary ideas start to kick in, because I have a concept of love and a concept of hate, and I see them wrapped up in evolution in terms of how it is that we deal with cheats, so that we can be altruistic in the information we have. It's incredibly beneficial to be altruistic with information, to be altruistic with knowledge, because knowledge can be shared across kin, across families, can be shared with anyone. So altruism in knowledge is incredibly useful. And how do you enable altruism to happen? Well, you enable altruism to happen by finding a way of destroying cheats. Okay, so coming back to the original balance where we talked about the balance of decision, where you're comparing two emotional profits of two behaviors, you compare those two behaviors. Now there is no reason, if you're empathetic, if you have empathy with someone, if you feel good and they feel good, and if you feel bad and they feel bad, that you can't internalize that emotional profit and actually optimize their emotional profit even above your own, because you are empathizing with them and their reward is your reward, because you feel good if they feel good and you feel bad if they feel bad. And that then results in drive, and the drive to care for them. And when you have that action tendency, that drive to care for someone, that is what we describe as feeling love and feeling compassion and feeling love for somebody else, when we feel that drive. So it's not a chemical in the brain. It is oxytocin. I'm sure oxytocin plays a role in it, but it's the action, the drive. It's a dopamine thing, and it's the drive to actually help someone. Now, the corollary of that is that if you feel good and I feel bad, and if I feel bad and you feel good, yeah, so when you feel good, it makes me feel bad, that's hatred. And the fairness balance that I described before, when it gets out of kilter, when someone's cheated you in your fairness balance, you hate them. You hate them. Now, you don't have to hate them in today's society where we have the law. So where you have police, courts, and prison officers. But when there were no police, no courts, and prison officers, we had to do it ourselves socially in the group. And the way we did that was we had hate. And if someone cheated, then they would cause rupture in the group. And hatred is loud. Hatred is noisy. And hatred causes everyone in the group to lose. So hatred is a deterrent, like the police. And hatred is a court. Because once someone accuses one person of hatred, of cheating, and then another person accuses another person, ultimately the person who is cheating will be outed in this hate campaign, in this hate democracy, in this hate attack where everyone's attacking each other. The person who genuinely cheats is likely to be the one who is going to lose in that scenario. And the third thing is, and this is something which is unpalatable to most people to accept of humans, but in the context of understanding what hatred is for, hatred enables you to punish. And it is bizarre, in fact, when you consider how appalled we are that people in Victorian times, in Edwardian times, would go out on a Sunday afternoon with their children, have a picnic and watch someone being executed and enjoy the hanging. And we find that strange. Well, I think it's because we actually live in denial of our own feelings, and actually we could enjoy a good hanging, but it's not socially acceptable to do it. It's also not socially necessary to do it, because why would we need to hate? But what I'm saying is the human emotion is natural. To enjoy, if someone has cheated you, to take pleasure from their punishment empowers you to punish them. But it's not the case that you're empowered to punish them, that you would do that because you'd want to kill them. I don't think hate's made to kill people. Hate is long-term and sustained emotional distancing, and it means that you can expel the person from the social group. You can push them into the wilderness, push them into the hills, push them into the forest, away from the social group. Because there's no interest in killing that person. Because if they're an adult, they are bone and muscle and brain that is developed and mature and survived. And you wouldn't want to kill it. You'd want to keep it. It could be useful. So you incubate it. And that's why human beings, when they're isolated from the social group, become depressed. And that is nature's way of incubating problem people. Push them out of the social group, put them depressed so that they are passive and they don't cause any harm to anyone. And when you need them again, you warm them back up again. Okay, so what that then, these ideas of emotional value then make us, and balances, and these ideas of love and hate as a way of dealing with Dawkins' problem of cheats. Because Richard Dawkins, who's a lovely man, but is wrong about many things. And one of the things is he's wrong about human evolution. Because he says that we have selfish genes because we can't do altruism because there'll always be a cheat. Well, I'm sorry, Richard Dawkins, but the irony that the hate-filled, vile emails you received when you said that God is a delusion was actually an expression of the very mechanism that proves your theories of biology are wrong. And you didn't understand that, and you were appalled at the humanity of these Christians who are actually acting rationally in response to someone who challenged the very core of their belief. So Richard Dawkins would tell people, you know, about these terrible Christians who threatened to kill him and have all this vile and hatred for him and be shocked at it. In actual fact, it is natural that people would feel that way. The point is that it's unnecessary in democracy to have hate. And I think because a democracy is about the legal system, you know, half democracy is the court, 12 men, fair and honest, 12 men in court, and the rest is the other half is the people in parliament. So democracy is about the law. And so democracy is about the law, and it is not necessary when you have an efficient legal system to hate people. So a democracy shouldn't have hatred in it. In fact, it's unnecessary. Okay, so let's have another look at evolution then. So we've got rid of the need for selfish genes, or we've got rid of the whole concept of a human selfish gene is out the window, because in humans we have knowledge which we can transfer without having sex. The pillow talk is always good, but yeah, you don't have to have pillow talk. You can have pub talk, you can have football talk, you can have any kind of talk you want, and you can share knowledge. And so knowledge can be shared across kin, and therefore it makes sense to be able to do that altruistically. It was more efficient, and you can do it, and you can have altruism because you have hate, which stops people from cheating you. So, but what else can we say about human evolution? I think there's more to be said about human evolution than even Darwin was saying. Although I'm sure that if you look at my ideas on evolution, Darwin probably had already thought of these ideas, but it hasn't been noticed that he was alluding to these ideas. So I'm not saying that I've got new ideas for Darwin, but maybe new perspectives that we haven't seen in Darwin. And that is this whole concept of the adaptable ape hypothesis, which is that we are adaptable apes, that we evolved to be adaptable rather than to be adapted, that we didn't evolve to be made specifically for the savanna desert, or the savanna plains, or even for the seas around Africa, the aquatic ape theory. But in actual fact, nature made us adaptable, and there's a very good reason why this would be, because if nature selects adaptability, then I can learn very, very rapidly. So, for example, a giraffe can't be adaptable because it has a long neck and it has long legs, and it's somewhat stuck in its niche. And a giraffe neck grew longer as it went up to get leaves from the higher tree, from high in the trees, and the giraffe evolved genetically in order to do this. But an adaptable person, a man, a giraffe would take maybe 20,000 years or 100,000 years to grow, to develop a neck long enough to reach the leaves at the top of the tree, whereas a person, a man, could invent a ladder in a morning and have the entire fruit from the tree stripped by the afternoon, in one day, inventing the ladder. So you can see that nature will always choose a developmental adaptability over adaptedness, because developmental adaptability is faster, and evolution is a race. It's the fastest to develop that matters. And so, and then in the context of language and knowledge, the adaptability became much more important and much more profound, and therefore we are adaptable apes, not adapted apes, which is very exciting. Now, what I haven't talked about with, so moving on, so we've talked about some ideas about how neuroscience might work. We've talked about ideas about how emotion and cognition might work. We've talked about ideas about evolution. But let's move on now to this knowledge evolution and see how that progressed. Because knowledge evolution progressed into what I consider to be capital evolution. And that capital is an expression of evolution. Because it is evolutionary. And the mechanisms around capital, which is profit and the comparison of profit and markets, is very similar to what actually happens in the brain in terms of emotional profit, if I'm right about that. And also, and this was shocking, really, it's quite shocking that it took me so long to realize the connection. But having discovered 20 years ago the balance, and then having trained as a chartered accountant, that I did the balance sheet, the profit and loss, which is an unequal arm balance. A profit and loss is an unequal arm balance because it gives you a relative result, not an absolute more or less like a balance sheet, either balanced not balanced, but actually how much more profit there is, or how much less profit is, or how much loss there is. So the balance sheet, the trial balance, and so it is ironic that the capitalist system of markets based around profit companies using double entry bookkeeping and balances could be exactly the way the brain does it. And I don't think it's a coincidence that in the brain you have reinforcement, you have reward and cost, and in accounting you have reward and punishment, and in accounting you have revenue and cost. And I don't think it's a coincidence that there are debits and credits, and in the brain there is inhibition and propagation. And I don't think it's a coincidence that there are balances. I think it's because we reinvented what the brain does without knowing it. However, this all leads to some pretty interesting possible ideas about how information can be organized in a company. And one of the things would be that the brain clearly has some kind of model of the world inside it that it builds up through these balances, learning actual versus imagined, and learning behavior, relationships between behavior, predictions in the brain, and some kind of model of the brain. So why wouldn't a company have a similar model? So that's where I came up with the idea for adaptable capital, where I said that the company would be a simulation of everything, a model of itself, and that model would continuously forecast. So don't forget that in accounting, you have monthly, yearly processes, and they're rubbish. You know, budgeting yearly is a disaster. It simply does not work as a system, but there's nothing better. We're stuck with it. Well, there is something better. I've invented it, adaptable capital. You create a simulation of the company and you continuously forecast. Now, the thing is, for that, you need to invent something, which I have done. I've sent it to the Chartered Institute of Management Accounting, and they think it's a very good invention. And it's basically a way whereby you actually get rid of ledgers and you get rid of balances, because you say, you know what, digital computers don't do balances, don't need to do ledgers and accounts. And we know that an item in a company that you purchase or sell has an order date, a delivery date, a payment date, a use-by date, an installation and use-by date, even a refund date, and an amount. So they're all dates. And from those dates, it's quite easy to create an algorithm which will turn those relative dates into a cash position and a balance sheet positions, financial standing and a financial status position, a profit position and a balance sheet position of the company continuously, not just monthly, but continuously, so that you can continuously forecast, compare the past with the past, the present with the past, the future with the future, comparing any point and any point in time that you want, any period in time, not restricted by monthly or yearly budgets, but actually continuously. So in actual fact, there are three cycles to a company. There's the monthly reporting cycle, which is driven by depreciation and prepayments. And then there is the processing of them through the ledgers. Complete waste of time, could be done continuously by creating reports directly from the items based on the dates and the amounts, creating reports directly. And then so you have monthly reporting covered, and then you have the yearly budget, and you wouldn't need to do a yearly budget at all. You continuously forecast, make amendments to your model whenever you want to. It makes the company very agile, very flexible. And the other good thing is anyone can download the simulation. It's not a pyramid with the CEO at the top. Anyone in the organization can download that model, can optimize that model, can feed into that model, can change that model. So it becomes a democratized system, and the CEO really loses a lot of his power in the organization. And you have, so there was the first two points. The one is the monthly reporting, which is to calculate the balance sheet and P&L for a period. Then the budgeting reporting, which is annual, and then the other periodic valuation, periodic calculation, is the value of the business. And the value of the business is done when it's acquired, and this can all three processes can be done at the same time: the monthly, the budgeting, and the valuation, because you can continuously value the future discounted cash flows of the business. You can continuously value the future discounted cash flows of the business. Sorry, my son is making quite a lot of noise there. he's making an awful lot of noise. But you have a continuous cycle. And then why not make it into a game? And the other important idea is if you have these simulations, if you have one simulation, you can forecast 1 week. If you have 100 simulations, you can share information between the simulations about their futures and about what they're doing. And then you can forecast reliably maybe a month. And if you had 10,000, you could forecast 3 months. And if you had 1,000,000 simulations all sharing data, you could forecast a year. And that's a totally different world. The ability to forecast into the future and know the future because you're sharing the future. And it all fits in with this word that I actually came up with today, thanks to the Facebook group with my lovely friends on Facebook. I came up with the word knowledge altruism. Thanks to knowledge altruism, it's possible that you share information with each other. And the other thing is that you open the if you're going to share the forecast, you have to open the processes. So you have to open the entire business. And so a business is essentially three things: process, property, and people in a pyramid. Yeah, process, property, and people. And basically the processes all become open and transparent, and software creates all the processes, and all the software is open source, and all the software can be downloaded. And so then it is property and people which are the determinants of the value that the entrepreneur creates through his leadership and his decisions. and that drives the value of the business, no longer the process. So what we're doing here is actually doing something quite wonderful, and I have to say I'm really excited about this, because I think this is going to change the world, this is going to change your world, and it's going to make our world a better place. And this is why at this time of night on a Thursday night I'm recording this, because I believe this is vitally important. It was my friend Carlos who pointed this out to me, information asymmetry, and my friend John Shaw pointed out about process friction. Sharing information means there's no longer information asymmetry. One big player doesn't have all the information. And process friction means that there's no benefit from being big, because the processes are frictionless. So what it means is there's no benefit to being a big company. And we need to do something about the big companies in the world, because they are corrupting our governments, and they are sitting on piles of cash. They're not investing. They're stagnating our economies. And they buy anyone up who's a threat. They buy each other, and they buy anyone up who's a threat. So it's affecting the very it ends up with bad capitalism, lack of competition, bad democracy, and we need to do something about it. And I don't believe in the Illuminati, but I think the concept of the Illuminati is interesting, in that these large, powerful billionaire groups are too powerful. And I think it's a consciousness that they're too powerful. So I'm not an advocate of the Illuminati, but I'm an advocate of an open-arty. So if you put in a URL, openarty.com, openarty is a name I came up with for what I'm trying to do. The openarty, which is the opposite of the Illuminati, which is an open society with completely open information, and anyone can join. So I am the openarty. So Illuminati out there. Illuminati, watch out for me, because I'm coming to get you. I'm the open arty, and we're going to finish you off. Maybe not. I mean, I think I'm not so sure that focusing on the Illuminati is such a useful thing. But my point is that big corporations are not good for capitalism, because they reduce competition in the long term, and they affect democracies. And we would be far better to have new startups with new blood and new ideas coming into the markets. And that's the idea of adaptable capital. So if you look at my website, www.adaptableape.com, adaptableape.com, there are several tabs in there. The first one is an introduction, where I talk about the idea of balances, the idea of knowledge evolution, the idea of there being adaptable capital and new kinds of businesses, and how to implement that through a competition, through a game, which will be fun for people to take part in, and will encourage them to go into to be entrepreneurs. And then looking at democratic capitalism and some of the problems with our system. But I'm not going to focus on that right now, because it's political, and I can't change the politics of the world. Only you can do that. I can start a business and change things that way. And then there's something on the methodology. And now that I've covered most of my ideas, it's probably worth talking about the methodology. And the methodology is essentially when I came across the ideas of the balances, I looked at philosophy, and I found Socrates, and I realized that he really spoke to my heart. And I'm a Socratic, so my method is common sense, talk to ordinary people. I'm not a teacher, I'm a learner. You see, I think that Socrates never thought that learning and teaching were different things. To him, learning and teaching were the same thing. So a teacher who learns teaches better, and a learner who teaches learns better. So the whole platonic idea of the academy and the professor and the student is utter nonsense. And I don't use that at all. And I'm not interested in that at all. And I'm not interested in the idea that my ideas are my ideas. They're not. My ideas come from lots and lots of people who I talk to and get ideas from and share ideas with and get ideas because I talk to them. And so how can I say it's my idea? Even though I thought of it, I was talking to them at the time and they shared in the process that led to the creativity. So, yeah, so Socratic, yes, definitely. Mad, definitely. Bonkers, completely. I think out of the box because I'm bipolar. And, yes, it does cause me to be a bit crazy sometimes. So I've seen the face of God. I regularly see visions of the universe in front of my eyes. I have had massively grandiose ambitions my whole adult life, and they're manifesting now. My brain is hardwired, as someone describes it to me, for grandiosity and for doing big projects because I'm bipolar. The other thing about the bipolar is that I've learned to completely doubt my sanity at all times. I've been taught that by the mental health system. My family has installed that in me, doubting my sanity, doubting whether what I say is sensible, because I've been labelled bipolar, that I must talk crap. And to quote Julia Wassell, who's a local politician and actually head of psychiatry at the local university, how could you think in your two-bedroom flat that you would have any ideas that wouldn't that could have any meaning when there are academics who spent their entire lives thinking about these problems? You know, how could you think that? Well, if I wasn't bipolar, I would be allowed to think it. But I'm not, because I'm bipolar. So therefore, you know, how could I think it? I must be mad, is the conclusion. Because there's no reason why someone in a two-bedroom flat can't think of important things. If that was the case, the world would be very sad. And in fact, the world wouldn't be the world it is today if that was the case. And then the other thing, so I've talked about Socrates, I've talked about bipolar, this mood swings where I go from certainty to uncertainty, certainty to apathy. I'm not bipolar in respect of depression. I don't get depressed. I get apathetic sometimes and then I snap out of it and get on with my life. And I actually enjoy the apathy. Because I find I'm very, very manic and high a lot of the time. This is the bit that is a bit uncomfortable. I am very inspired by Einstein. Einstein said, I feel ideas, and I feel ideas. I don't know them, I feel they're correct before I develop them logically and you know, complete the idea. I'll have a feeling. So basically, all of the work I've done in the Adaptable Ape Hypothesis in the website adaptableape.com, I had predicted it in poetry. I'd written poetry about it before I did it, and then implemented it. So very, very regularly, I think something is going to be right, and then be not sure, and then find that my intuition is actually, you know, spot on. And of course I forget the times when my intuition's not spot on. Yeah. But Einsteinian ideas, talk to a barmaid, common sense. Believe me, Einstein, if you're listening, try talking to a barmaid in the 21st century and telling her you want to share her ideas because she's a barmaid and you want to see if she understands your ideas, because believe me, they don't like it. They take great offence. Who do you think I am? They will say to you, I may be a barmaid, but I'm perfectly intelligent, and I take offence at your assuming that I'm not intelligent. That doesn't work. The general Einsteinian idea of 90% perspiration, 10% inspiration is pretty much been my life. One final point I would say is I am a fucking genius, and yes, basically I am, and I would not recommend anyone to be a genius. It absolutely sucks. You spend your entire life being misunderstood, not listened to, ignored, you are frustrated, you are put down, because you have to think in a completely, completely different way to everyone else. And it sucks. So anyone out there who wants their child to be a genius, you're committing an act of cruelty against your child. And I would gladly give up my genius and be normal and not be bipolar. I would gladly swap it. I'm scratching my nose, so maybe I don't really believe that. But I would give up. I would. If I could press a button and make it go away and not be the person that I am. I often thought that I would do that because I thought that someone else would have the ideas and someone else will do it. I'm wondering whether actually that's true. If I didn't do what I'm doing now, which is theadaptableape.com, pushing the ideas forward, whether anyone else would do it, I don't know. I hope to think that they would, but I'm afraid to feel that they wouldn't necessarily do it, and I can't take that risk, so I'm going to push the ideas forward, and I'm glad that I can push the ideas forward. So apologies for my lack of modesty, but I've been labelled as mentally ill for 20 years, and I'm not mentally ill. I'm basically different and very creative and very imaginative. I've imagined God's face. I've closed my eyes and I've seen on a television screen, like a television screen, God's face. And that's for another video. Suffice to say that he was quite ugly. But I don't for a moment believe that it was God's face. It's my imagination, the same imagination that makes me see the universe in front of my eyes. Even when I open my eyes, it's still there. When I'm high, when I'm in a deep state of chemical activity, it's my imagination. It's the power of my imagination. It's not real. So I think that's enough. Suffice to say that I think that it's quite possible that my weighted balance, or I called it weighted balance, unequal arm balance, this idea of the fulcrum moving and coming into equilibrium and showing you the relative. The brain is a comparison engine. It's not just a prediction engine, it's a comparison engine, it's a matching engine. It matches reward to cost to create profits. And I think this is the basis for future AI. And I think I've uncovered the secrets of how the mind works and laid down the principles for future AI. And if I have, then watch out. Facebook, Microsoft, Google, because Elon Musk predicted that the person who has AI will be incredibly powerful and be able to change things in the world. And he did say, Elon Musk, that the real threat of AI is that it wouldn't be democratic, that it wouldn't be done democratically, that it would be done unilaterally. And I intend to make it democratic, but I intend to use I really think that I've made the most important breakthrough forward in neuroscience that there's been, that I am the Einstein of the mind. And I intend to use that position to bring about, not change in the world, because I don't want to change the world. I don't want to change people. I like people as they are. But I want to get rid of the rubbish. I want to get rid of the stupid corporations and their ridiculous hierarchy and their controlling and their fear and their... I want to get rid of all of that, and I want to get rid of the fear that people have to live with every day, that they'll lose their job or that the world will blow up, or so that they can just get on with their ordinary lives, which are beautiful and wonderful things. Beautiful and wonderful things. What I want. I don't want to change people. I don't want to change. I want to get rid of the rubbish. And I liken it to flushing the toilet. I want to flush the toilet of the world and get rid of all the crap. and the crap is politics and economics. Mainly it's politics and economics, which in my country and in other countries around the world is fueled by people who studied philosophy, politics and economics. And I want to replace that philosophy with a grounding of solid, and not just the crappy ideas I'm talking about tonight. I mean proper research that proves that the ideas are solid and sound as a bedrock of not philosophy but biology, and that we build our economics and politics on biology, on fact, on science, and that biology become that economics becomes like electricity. You know, you don't have a debate in electricity anymore between AC and DC, or between, you know, between different forms of current, or, you know, we all use electricity. No one argues and debates about electricity and the way you have left wing and right wing, or different views of politics and economics in the world. We have consensus. So I'm looking for that kind of consensus in politics and economics. So the people who I love, which is the ordinary people that I've shared my life with, not academics, not intellectuals, but ordinary people that I've shared my life with, so they can just get on with their lives. That's my dream. And for me, what I would like is, I like talking to people. And if I can become well known and get to talk to more people, then that would be great, because I love it. I love talking to people. So there you go. I like people, and I like me. And my mother killed herself when I was 4, and that led to a lot of the problems that I've had. And I would say, yeah, I like people, and I like me, and I hope you like me too, and I hope you like my ideas, and let's fucking change the world. Or rather, not change the world, but flush the toilet. Yeah, reverse that. Let's flush the toilet and get on with creating a better system so that we don't change the world, but allow people to get on with their lives. So, yeah. Love makes you grow.